That was, of course, the opening sequence of the very first episode of Doctor Who, and you directed several. I'm trying to take you back. You were 23, new in the drama department. Verity Lambert, the producer, is this young woman. How did you come to get the job?
Actually, I seem to be always the second one online. There was actually another director involved, and I was the most junior Indian-born doing my bit. And the director who was allocated this particular show, which was meant to be a children's series, decided he thought it was a load of whatever. So he decided to quit. And they thought, now who can we replace this person with? And what did they do? Well, what about that little guy over there who wants to do things? So I was brought in, and that was the start. I found myself with the first ever female producer in drama in television, Verity Lambert, and she and I formed a very strong relationship because we were basically outsiders and we had no idea how this thing was going to go. And here we are talking about it today.
I know. And one of the great things we've got is you've got your original scripts with a hand-annotated kind of camera marking. So we're going to look at some of them, because I want a sense of how, not only were you shooting something that had never been shot before, but you had to work out what to do with the technology of the day. So talk me through what you did as a director in marking up that script and how it then translated into what we saw on screen. So I think the third still in particular, is that the one where we really get a sense of
how you
worked everything out?
You know,
out?
What it really is that you get a script, and this happened in all the dramas we ever dealt with. You get a script with the writing on it. You have to imagine what you want to do with it. You have to prepare it. You're given a floor plan that within the space of a studio, and the designer gives you his ideas of how he thinks you can shoot this.
So we're seeing the
And
the
now what you do is you've got a floor plan there. Now you can see how confined that space is, containing about four different sets. And what I have to do is to imagine how I'm going to shoot it. I've got four cameras which I shoot simultaneously, all with cables. This is almost a mathematical situation. I'm not good at maths. But you sit down with a floor plan, you imagine how you're going to want to see it in each of those sets, and that's how you shoot it. I do my first one with my own writing, with my lines saying where I think the cuts should come. They're all pre-thought out. It's nothing to do with well, you can adjust once you're in a control room, but basically it's all done ahead of time. The actors and I then rehearse in some outside rehearsal room with yellow tapes on the floor, and they represent the sets. And that then takes its own shape and form, so by the time you're in the studio, you've got, in our case with Doctor Who, it was a half an hour show, one day to shoot it in.
And I think one thing that really comes across when we see more of your clips is what I love about seeing your work and the whole atmosphere of 60s television is how live it feels, because it is shot quite quickly. Everything is put into capturing a real moment.
It has to be shot as we rehearsed, and there's very few times or space for actually adjusting. In those days, tapes were very costly. We were only allowed 3 tape breaks per show. So everything you see, and by the way, Passage to India were shot in the same way, 4 cameras continuously.
Now, we should say, of course, you've actually been portrayed yourself by Sacha Dhawan in Mark Gatiss's drama about the creation of Doctor Who, An Adventure in Space and Time. And I wonder how you feel about your role in what is now kind of legendary television.
Well,
it's
not very often you're portrayed while you're still alive. I mean, I guess, there are a few people who've been privileged like the Queen. But the fact is... No, I was very thrilled when they decided to do how the whole thing originated. And I was able to work with Mark Gatiss, who wrote the script. And I gave him a few reality checks.
Oh, really?
Because for one thing, in the original script, he thought the entire thing was shot on one camera. I said, Domark, we sat in a control room with four cameras and things went wrong. And, you know, subject to all sorts of trial and error. So he understood that and he incorporated it into his final script. There was a wonderful moment when he had Verity Lambert living in a basement flat in Bayswater, which in those days was Rackman land. And she was waiting for a job. I said, no, Mark, she was actually living in Eaton Mews South. And and he said, and she never traveled by bus. He said, oh, my God. He said, but I want her to travel in a bus. I said, well, you can do that, but just make it an exception to the rule. So I did help towards making this show towards what it actually was. And Sasha was, I thought, wonderful. I was quite flattered that he played me so well.
Absolutely. Well, you mentioned the whole thing about four cameras and everything. You worked with essentially in that period is done that way. TV drama was such a big part of your career when you were starting off at the BBC. As you say, much done live or as live, with everything worked on in advance. We're going to look at clips from two that you did in the 60s. Kipling's The Sending of Dana Da, starring Warren Mitchell, and a 30-minute theatre, Ella, which was live.
Live.
Absolutely live. Shall we see them and then... Or do you want to get us a line?
Well, I just want to say very quickly, Sending of Dana Da was in a Kipling series, and basically there were no Asian actors around cast. So what you're going to see is a lot of Caucasians speaking with very interesting Indian accents. So once you've seen that, forgive me. Okay.
So... It is amazing once you realise the whole thing is live, every element of the way that opening works and the elaboration of it. But also, you don't see it, but there's cooking and things going on.
Well, the whole thing was about cooking and eating and all live. God knows I was terrified things would go wrong. He was making a flambé at one point.
Yeah. cuts it and he's got it on his hand and he doesn't know what to do.
I mean, I thought the whole thing was going to go up in flames, but anyway, it was live. That's what I mean. Shot entirely with three cameras, four cameras actually.
What sort of technical knowledge did you need? Because you said you're good at maths.
Well, the thing is, all of that was mapped out in advance, prepared with all the cuts and everything. And I was praying that all the actors would hit their right marks. And, you know, because I do all sorts of elaborate camera moves and going into mirrors and things. And I kept thinking, one camera is going to see another one. And, you know, there'd be a terrible accident. But that would actually work beautifully. And Vivian was wonderful. They both were all the guys. You know,
yeah,
I loved Edward Woodward.
Great.
And
the Kipling. Yeah. You know, we talked about casting
Kipling,
a bit earlier.
Yes.
How significant was it when... I don't know how you felt even at the time with the casting. Because
it has
a great sense of place.
Had a sense of place, but the people in it... You know, I mean, let's face it, it's very difficult when you know that these people are not Indians. They're trying their best. And, you know, Nari Dawn Porter had just done the Forsyte Saga. And there she was in a black wig being a Punjabi prostitute. I mean, you know, one has to give and take on these events and hope for the best.
Was it, as an actor, as a director, I wonder, was there an additional level of awkwardness or anything because you had an Indian background in directing something like this? Or you thought, I'd rather it were me than... Well, it could have been even.
Well, of course, no. Actually, the funny thing was, and I'm very happy to say this, I was given so much leeway to do other things. Yeah. I mean, I just didn't want to be stuck with ethnic stories, and anyway, there weren't any, apart from the Kipling series. So I was lucky enough to be able to branch out. But I did manage to point out, when I was first allotted a Kipling episode, I walked onto the set, and I saw this wonderful wallpaper and Victorian furniture in a set in India. I said, excuse me, folks, but wallpaper just wouldn't have stuck to the walls in India. So and the poor art director, I mean, he nearly killed me, because they had to go away and whitewash all the walls and take away the wallpaper because nobody had done their research. So in a way, I possibly saved them. I don't know. But that was my background speaking. Otherwise, I don't know, it would have been another inaccurate assessment of what I think would have been disaster.
Did you talk about Michael Bates when you were introducing Passage to India?
Ah, Michael Bates. Now, it's so interesting because Godbole is the only Englishman playing an Indian in it.
No, we should say this is a Passage to India. And Michael Bates, some of you might know, of course, was very famous being in a half hot mum.
Exactly. But you know what? He'd had a very long history in India. He grew up there. He knew what the rhythms of speech were.
He spoke beautifully.
And he gave it a wonderful sense of dignity, unlike someone else who portrayed him later on.
I wonder who that could be in the film. Right, well, let's talk a bit more about drama. And one of the things which, again, we realize we're in another era, the format of topical TV plays has pretty much disappeared from TV, but it was a huge part of the 60s and 70s and right into the 80s. And you took on really gritty topics. And we have two stills here from your series of The Wednesday Play, which you did in 1966 and 67. The Connoisseur, which I think you've described as being about corruption in a public school. And this is Sleeping Dog. And I'm just going to read you the plot summary on IMDb of this. A black barman upsets a colonial governor who has just retired and returned to England. He locks the barman in the cellar and treats him like an animal. It's hard to believe such things could be tackled in the same way now. And I wondered how difficult they were to direct even then.
Well, I think, interesting enough, it was, first of all, it's a Simon Gray script. And Simon wrote some very controversial pieces, and this is one of them. About colonialism and about the relationship between whites and blacks. At the time we were doing it, I didn't realize the significance of it to the point now it is so relevant today. I don't even think that it would be sanctioned anymore because it's non-PC. I mean, the idea of a white man treating a man like a dog in a cellar in a house. Johnny Secker played the African. He was wonderful. And Marius Goring and Rachel Kempson played the wife. So these, unfortunately, have been wiped. The other one was about corruption in a sort of Eton-type school.
Sort of older boys corrupting
older boys corrupting younger ones. Boys. Again, a controversial subject. I wish it was still around to be
is that
seen.
Richard O'Sullivan?
Pardon?
Who's the young man?
That is Richard.
Richard O'Sullivan.
And Michael Goodliffe played his father, who played the school chaplain, and father and son. But the father belonged to another house, and the boy belonged to another house. And the one who was the corrupter was Ian Ogilvie. So before he became the saint.
Gosh, it's a shame this hasn't survived.
Actually, again, it's a very that show. Actually, I think still exists.
Right, Mission. We need to find it, and we need
It's called The Connoisseur. It's about corrupt schools, and it was written by Hugo Chartres, who was basing it on Eton.
Was there a lot more editorial freedom, including a kind of, almost a mission to provoke with the kind of writing?
I think there was, but it was meant not to provoke, but to think. The whole thing about the Wednesday play was that every Wednesday, a television audience was told that there would be something to watch. You see, today we're depending on series. It goes on for episodes. Those are self-contained, written by well-known writers, Simon Gray being one of them. But he and I started our careers virtually together. He then became very famous subsequently. But at the time, he was writing these pieces, and I was working with him as a director. I was privileged enough to get to work with him, as I was later on with someone more established like Arnold Wesker. I mean, that was the privilege of myself being a director who was able to deal with this kind of controversial subject matter. But unfortunately, they no longer exist.
Can I ask as well, this is a period when, you know, racial prejudice was more overt, homosexuality was still, you know, criminal until it was partially decriminalized in 1967. And can I ask, in your own experience working and living, you know, in London, what was your experience of prejudice in your career?
To be honest, I don't think that there was any open. Basically, whatever I felt was within myself. I felt because of my background and my being an artist, I needed to do my best because I was terrified of stumbling on the set and not knowing what I had to do because of the crew. There were all these men standing around saying, prove something, in my head. Mm. In all fairness, I did not encounter any overt sense of prejudice, but I was fully aware of my background and having to constantly prove myself by being on top of the game. I could not afford to stumble. That's basically my philosophy.
Well, we're talking in the centenary year, indeed in the centenary day of some women getting the vote. And remarkably, as Marcus hinted when he introduced us, to till now, you've been the only one to direct a proper full TV drama series about the suffrage movement. Yes. So we're going to have a look at a clip from the 1974 series Shoulder to Shoulder, and this is from the episode about Annie Kenney. Oh, that's brilliant. I was thinking, when we write the drama about the BBC Women's Battle for Equal Pay, I hope you'll direct it, cast it. That was a big budget thing. It had Warner Brothers kind of co-producing it. And I'm interested in, again, was there a sense of you being drawn to telling some of these stories that were outsider stories, these kind of moments of breakthrough, aren't they?
They are, and actually, the strange thing was that I was offered this by Verity Lambert. The entire production team consisted of women. And she actually, in her wisdom, I think, said, look, we can't just have everybody just an all-woman group. We need to get some kind of male view of it. And then she asked me to come in. And at the time, I didn't know anything about the suffragettes. I had to study it very carefully in order to be able to know what I was talking about. But what I was very fortunate in having was the cast. I mean, you just see Sian doing the most wonderful Mrs. Pankhurst. I mean, it delved into the ins and outs of what it meant, and it's so ironic that we're now talking that this particular year, and there's so much of it on television, and I'm seeing newsreels of these women. And so by the time I got involved, I got thoroughly absorbed. And it is about being outsiders as well. These women were outsiders. They were fighting a system. And I have one sequence of events in a particular episode about Lady Constance Lytton, who was an aristocrat who disguised herself so to be an ordinary citizen. And there are incredibly gruesome scenes of force feeding in prison. And these women suffered a lot. So I went along with it. No, I thought they needed to be seen.
And two of the things that jumped out at me from the episode I saw was, I mean, as that clip shows, you weren't afraid of dealing with the complexities of class within
exactly,
the struggle.
Exactly.
And also the sense of what it meant when she finds her voice and she starts speaking, you know, this working class woman who's taking a platform, that
Annie.
Sense of finding your voice.
Yes, Annie Kenney. Yes.
The 1970s into the 80s is something of a golden age in directing generally, but with your work as well, these big historical dramas, beautifully costumed and set, that sense of place. And we will be talking about Edward and Mrs. Simpson very shortly. But there's another theme when we talk about outsiders in your work, which is tackling anti-Semitism. And we've got a still of you with Tom Conti on the set of The Glittering Prizes, which was, of course, based on Frederick Raphael's book and script following a kind of group of Cambridge friends and Tom's character being Jewish, though not Tom himself. And I wondered if you could just tell us briefly before we show clips about his casting.
That's so interesting, because actually I went to a public school in Bristol called Clifton, where there was actually a house for Jewish boys. So, because that was the situation, and I never really thought about it until we came to casting this particular series. And you know, all the kids who were in my school became lawyers, doctors, incredible professionals. We could not find this character's meant to be an upper middle class Jewish boy. And we couldn't find any actors in that caliber area. So we had to offer it around. And I saw Tom Conti on a monitor doing Madame Bovary. He was playing Bovary, and Charles Bovary. And there was something about Tom, and I went to the producers and I said, have a look at him. So we sent him the script, and he said, if you don't give me this part, I'll commit harakiri at the gates of the television center. So he got the role. And the funny thing was that he and Freddie Raphael just did that together. They became lifelong friends. But the funny thing was that when this show went out in New York, and especially New York, the amount of Jewish princesses who wanted to propose to Tom Conti, because they all thought he was Jewish and he wasn't. And when we came to do certain scenes, none of us had any idea. We had to get an advisor in on how to do certain scenes, like Friday night at family.
Kind of Jewish cultural advisor.
Yes, but anyway, Tom played it, and that's where, and there's me with hair. Whatever's left of it.
I think you look very nice now. Right, we're going to show you a couple of clips then. We're going to take a look at the glittering prizes from 1976, and then in the same kind of role with it, Fall from Grace, which is 1994, a huge on-location miniseries for Sky starring Tara Fitzgerald, Michael York and James Fox, about a young Anglo-French woman who takes on the terrible risks and costs of becoming an SOE agent in Nazi-occupied France. It's a great miniseries. It's grim viewing as well. Do you want to start with the technicality of that scene? Because you're very proud of that.
I'm proud of it because we had half a day to shoot it in, and I didn't have Christopher Nolan's money. I tried my best to do what I'm. That's an. By the way, that editing is brilliant from my friend Laurence Clark, who did it. There were two planes. She made it look like more. And that whole thing was a speculative thing. Would we be able to get those explosions happening? We had all these extras. And I insisted on doing that scene because I was influenced by a French film called Les Jeux Interdits, which was all about people leaving cities and being killed on the road by the Germans. And I just felt it was for me to be able to show more than just people in living rooms. And I could do spectacular action within the framework of my budget. So that in contrast to what Tom says in that scene, which I think he does brilliantly. So we've got the contrast of the two situations.
And also, I mean, we were saying earlier that theme about anti-Semitism and the anger of how it was still being denied and the kind of the atrocity of it.
Yes.
You weren't afraid of just taking that on repeatedly.
Exactly.
Material. The story of Fall from Grace is from a novel, but the idea of this agent played by Tara Fitzgerald, it's based on someone real, isn't it?
Yes, well, Larry Collins wrote the book, and I asked him, I said, is this girl, she was Anglo-French in the script. I said, is this based on a woman called Noor Inayat Khan? And she was actually half Indian and half American, and she was a true story. And her life has never been celebrated in film, though I've tried to make it and other people have tried to script it. The films about heroines during the war who were sent into fight for the SOE, there was one wonderful film made by with Ginny McKenna called Carve Her Name with Pride. Mm. And then there was...
Odette as well.
Odette. Yeah. So those two were celebrated, and I always felt that so should Noor. But alas, they changed it into the script into an Anglo-French girl. And I said to Larry, was that based on her? And he was, oh, no, not at all. But actually, he'd written a book called Freedom at Midnight, so he knew all about her. And I just think for commercial purposes at that time, it would not have been able to finance a picture with a half-Indian girl in it. Mm-hmm. You see what I'm saying? We moved on now, and they probably will make it.
One of the things I wanted to ask is, you don't shy away from the horrific torture that agents like her faced, if they were compromised. Yeah. And there's a sequence quite early on with one of her fellow agents has been betrayed, and you see the start of the torture and then you see the aftermath. And I wondered how you chose to shoot those sequences, because they are disturbing, but I'm conscious that you were careful about
what
you showed.
Well, you have to be. I mean, there's a certain limit to violence. I mean, I don't believe in too much violence. I when I watch it on screen with someone else directing it, I'm already, in that state of disrepair. But you can always imply it. I think violence doesn't have to be shown. It has to be implied or seen off camera. And the results of it you can see, possibly, but not the actual act. So when we did Fall from Grace, I had to show certain scenes which showed the horror which this poor woman was going to have to deal with, because she was betrayed by both sides. She was sent by the secret organization knowing that she'd probably be caught, and she was.
Right, we're going to talk about something a bit happier now, which is your work on one of the most renowned TV dramas ever made. Long before The Crown, you directed Edward and Mrs. Simpson for Thames, a seven-part drama about the abdication of Edward VIII. It won an Emmy, it won 9 BAFTAs. I must say, watching it ahead of this evening, it's been a personal highlight for me, because I hadn't watched it since I was a child. And we're going to see a clip from that, and we're also going to see a clip from Laurence Olivier Presents, Daphne Loriola, for Granada. It's a 1949 play, him and Joan Plowright, and I think Arthur Lowe among the cast, both 1978. Shall we see them and then we can talk about them?
Yes.
What was it like directing Olivier and Shakespeare?
Oh, well, first of all, it was a huge privilege. I mean, he was wonderful to work with, and so was Joan. I mean, it's very hard to describe these situations when you're working with legends, but as you could see, I thought he did such a marvelous bit there. That scene was so moving and genuine, you know, all I needed to do was guide him into a particular situation and then leave him to it. It wasn't like he needed too much, but you see, when you're of that experience and that kind of ability, and it's very hard for me as a director to say where I stopped and he started. It was so much a part of this was a classic play that was done years ago on stage with Edith Evans playing the Joan part, Joan playing Edith's part. But the point is, just looking at it again, I can't help feeling very proud of it because of him,
And we can forget that, you know, actors of his generation completely embrace the camera and what
Absolutely.
It could do to capture
yes.
theatre
and
on screen.
Bring it right down and make it into something very genuine and felt. I mean, I just thought he was wonderful in this scene, so I'm glad you saw
it's
it.
It's not getting a screening at a part of the season because it's so, the play is so funny. It's got this huge range of tones.
It is. It's a very strange play, actually.
All these younger parts
there's a whole story about how we actually got to do it, but anyway. But I'm glad I did it.
Edward and Mrs. Simpson. Now, you've said the script was king, but on Edward and Mrs. Simpson, there's so much that seems perfect. So the costuming, the sets, there's location work, the music. I mean, it's an amazingly atmospheric.
Yes.
What did it feel at the time that you had everything that you needed to do something?
Absolutely.
Special?
But you know, things today we are seeing shows like The Crown, which have budgets that are huge, and we didn't have that kind of privilege. But we did have time to prepare. So it was based on a book by Francis Donaldson, and we had to follow very closely to the actual facts because we couldn't afford to play around with them. This was, after all, the Duchess herself was still alive at the time we were shooting, and she had a fearsome lawyer, a female lady, I call her lady, she wasn't, called Maitre Bloom. That already gives it a masculine texture. But she threatened to sue us if we said anything untowards their relationship. For instance, according to her, they had no physical relationship until the abdication, which is ridiculous, because they went on the Nile in on the boat and everything. But anyway, I had to be very careful how I portrayed this relationship. And so we were working under a lot of constraints, but what I was privileged to have with Thames Television behind us was to prepare it. We prepared this show for almost a year, because I did all 7 episodes. And that took a long time because I had to really sit with the designer and the costume people and the look. We had to make the look right. And we were privileged enough actually to be able to film in Fort Belvedere, which now belonged to an Arab sheikh.
And that was his
Country retreat. And we actually managed to film the exteriors there. The interiors were all sets.
And tell me about Edward Fox, because we saw that abdication speech
yes.
there, which you shot in one take. It's
Absolutely.
Amazing, his performance.
Yes. Again, that was a big, first of all, full marks to Edward, because actually, if you listen to the recording of the actual abdication speech, he literally followed it to the hesitation and the way certain points where the actual Duke of Windsor, then King, paused. And Edward got every inflection right, but I dared to do it all. If you notice, it starts on a very high shot. It ends up on a very big close-up of him. And, you know, we thought, oh, my God, how many times are we going to have to do this, especially with him doing this thing without any prompting. He had nothing in front of him. He learned it. He did it in one take. So you saw it.
And again, thinking about the size of those cameras as well.
Oh, huge.
With actors, I know Virginia McKenna's been here with us this evening. I just wondered how performers felt. They just get used to having this thing coming, this huge thing in their face. I mean, that sort of all disappeared now from television.
Well, they do. I don't know how big the cameras are these days, but I will recall one incident. I was doing St. Joan, and John Gielgud was playing the Inquisitor, a long speech, and he was in the middle of this Shavian speech, and I said, "What's that terrible thing doing coming towards me?" Because he forgot his lines, and I said, "It's a camera, John." So, yes.
Right, we have some images from some of your other outstanding TV drama work, and I know one of these is sadly lost, isn't it? Hedda Gabler, 1972, with Janet Sussman.
No, it's not lost.
Is it lost? It's not lost.
No,
it's being screened.
We're screening it this coming week. No, please come.
It's not a tragedy after all. and Ian McKellen, of course. Yes. And we have Arnold Wesker's Chips with Everything as well. It's all from that, about national service recruits. Very much about class, then another issue.
Definitely,
about,
upper class, outsiders. Lower class, whatever you care to call it. Well, it was about national service, and Arnold was making a very strong statement about the class system and how people are ground into each other's dusts until they have to become somebody else or try to retain some form of dignity. It was quite an adventure for me because we actually shot it on location, no sets, again with four cameras and cables trailing back to a huge outside broadcast vans. I'd be sitting in an outside broadcast van looking at monitors, and all this was shot live virtually on video.
So it's essentially like an OB.
It was an OB,
like shooting the proms.
With actors, I mean, with the text. So, but I'm very proud of it again, partly because it had a very young cast. There were hardly any, there were no women in it except extras in a party scene. But it was all about these young, there were some really good talent now who've all grown up, of course. David Troughton being one of them, playing Smiler. He was wonderful.
Are there any favourite dramas out of all the ones you've directed?
Pardon?
Would you pick a favourite drama out of all the ones you've directed?
God, you know, it's terribly hard to answer that because I do have favourites, but I can't really list them because one or the other, then somebody else is going to get upset. No, but I...
Well, the drama's okay. Just listing favourite actors, it might be problematic.
Oh, actors is difficult as well because, again, one enjoys the people one works with. There are certain people I've had adventures with who weren't that great to work with, but then this happens in life, you know? I'm very happy to have done most of the stuff that I've been happy with.
Is there anything you've been unhappy to have done?
You probably go to see an example of one of them.
Okay, all right, we can tell us when we get... Oh, yes, oh,
I'll
God,
give
yes,
you a
we
chance
are.
To guess which.
I think it's coming up shortly. We'll see if we can guess. Right, not surprisingly, you were wooed by Hollywood and have become one of the few British directors actually moved to make television in the US. And in Britain, we often remember the soap operas that came our way, like Dallas. But TV networks in the US invested in very serious dramas about hard-hitting contemporary issues, not dissimilar to the kind of play for today's that we were looking at earlier. And we're going to look at two. Surviving, it's called, from 1985, which is about the families of two teenagers who commit suicide together. And it's young Molly Ringwald and Zach Galligan from Gremlins as the teenagers. And see if you can spot who plays the younger brother. But first, we're also in the same kind of clip role. We're going to see Divorce His, Divorce Hers, a story of a marriage breakup told from two points of view, all set in Rome. Unfortunately, the couple are the real life Richard Burton and Elizabeth Taylor. Basically the end of part one, and then part two is the whole of the family survive. And of course the young boy there was? River Phoenix. and did you have a role in casting at all?
Yes, in this case. Well, American television is different to ours because there's a lot of executive decisions made, and you have to submit your cast list to all sorts of people who vet it or say yes or no. And in this case, we had the privilege of some very good people. I had Ellen Burstyn playing the mother, and
Paul Savino is one of the fathers.
And that was Marcia Mason playing the mother. Molly Ringwald, of course, is a major name at that time. She'd done The Breakfast Club. And so to get her to do a teenage role, she actually wanted to do it because at the time her agents were saying, no, she's a feature film. She's a movie star. She doesn't do TV. But we got her, yeah.
And the world of these dramas, how different was it working there after British TV?
Totally different, because they're made like mini films. We shoot on 35mm films. Some of the stuff you've seen was all shot continuously on tape and video. No, these are shot like feature films, but on much tighter schedules. That particular show we shot in about 20 days. It was two parts, two hours, so it's not...
It was terrific, very moving.
And very little room for rehearsal.
Let's talk about the divorce one we saw a bit earlier. The budget on his divorce, her divorce, must have been huge. In location in Rome, I mean, it's amazing the sense of place. What was it like working with Burton and Taylor?
It was an adventure. And I learned a lot.
Well, you've written a screenplay about the experience, haven't you?
I have, actually, and I'm trying to get it made. It sounds like an ego trip, but it's not. It's really all about a young Indian with aspirations and ambitions. See how far he gets, and then it's a question of you get what you ask for.
Well, how did it come about? I mean...
Well, at the time I was asked to do it, it was going to be done as a television in Harlech, it was going to be shot in Bristol. It was the first time Elizabeth and Richard had ever done television, and it was going to be shot on tape. Thank God it wasn't, because you can't shoot continuously on tape with Elizabeth. You've got to frame her shots. Everything is organized in a way that shoots her at her best. There's certain angles that you simply cannot shoot. So I was very grateful when we didn't shoot it on tape, but the reason we didn't do it in Harlech was that suddenly we had a problem with taxes. We couldn't work in England for a certain number of days, so the whole thing went off and they got a deal. But you see, their name was so huge that companies were vying to do it, and we ended up with a German company financing, and so it became a mini film. And at that time, I was attached to it. I'm sure if it had started off as a feature or something else, I wouldn't have been involved. But at that time, I was on top of my game as a TV director who could do continuous shooting with four cameras. And so once it moved into the world of film, I was a part of it.
Tell me briefly, you bonded, didn't you, with Richard Burton?
Very
bonded
much so.
With you.
Oh, he was, I really, you know, he was a tragic figure, you know. He himself acknowledged that he said, you know, I'm Faust, and she's my Helen of Troy. And they actually did it on stage at Oxford. He was sort of frustrated academic, and he knew I'd been to Cambridge, so we had a bond, an academic bond. And then he took me aside one day and said, Warisco. By the way, he called me Warisco, which I allowed him to do. And he said, don't ever call me Dick. call me Richard. And he put his arm around me and said, I'm Welsh, you're Indian, we're not bloody English. So we bonded.
Excellent. Subjects of Empire bonded. Let's talk a bit about movies, because, of course, you did make the move into cinema in the late 60s, and we've got a still from A Touch of Love, which is screening on a couple of different dates here, from 1969. Oh, we've got going to do Copacabana first, are we? Let's do Copacabana first, because that was TV. Sorry, that's my mistake. So this is you with Barry Manilow's on there, on Copacabana, 1985.
Yes, and Annette O'Toole, who played Lola.
Yes, and the... screening that's taking place is from The Master.
Yes.
Which makes, I mean, I don't know why we...
They've got a 35mm copy, which I'm amazed by.
Yeah, it's in the BFI archive. But this is a moment in time, because this is television, it won an Emmy. But it does seem to be from another age, doesn't it? How would you describe it?
You mean the actual...
Well, I think
result?
Just the sort of... or the way we did it. Of it.
Well, of course. I mean, look, the song itself is legendary for between a certain group of people or fans of Barry's, but they decided to do a script about based on the song, and I was thrilled to get my hands on it. because we paid what we, within our budgets, of course, we were paying tribute to the MGM musicals, where people suddenly burst into song in the middle of a street. So there was I shooting on the back lot at Warner Brothers on the New York set. And there was Barry singing his heart out. And I was on a crane up there saying, I'm in Hollywood directing.
Oh, lovely.
I mean, what more of a thrill can you ask for when you're a director?
So now we take a jump back in time to the other story we had, which is A Touch of Love, yes. 1969. Based on the Margaret Drabble book and screenplay of her own novel about the young pregnant woman, The Millstone, Ian McKellen is the careless seducer of BBC TV newsreader. And Sandy Dennis is the lonely, neglected young university student. Eleanor Bron is their selfish best friend. I must say, I hadn't seen it until I got a chance to prepare, and it's my new favourite film of the 60s. And what I love is there's, I hadn't realised that a lot of the cast you had directed before at Cambridge.
Well,
there
were. it was my first film ever feature, and that was Ian's first film feature, which I keep reminding him about. And he didn't want to do it to start with. He said, no, 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 I'm a theatre director, a theatre actor. I said, no, 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 Ian, please help me. So we'd worked at Cambridge together. I directed him as Toby Belch in Twelfth Night. We had a lot of in common. So he said yes. And then Eleanor Brom was at Cambridge with me as well. So, and my friend Roger Hammond, another one. They all played friends in it. And Sandy was the American import. And the thing, fascinating thing was, at that time she'd already been nominated for, she was Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf? She played Honey. But she agreed to do the part, but she had to play in a middle-class English girl. And she was known for her American twitching and being very method. Mm. And I had to really grade her down in the best way I could.
She's great.
And I thought she was terrific. Yeah. There were moments when she would lapse into a kind of American accent or a mannerism, and I'd have to say, hey, 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 wait, Sandy, just listen to me. This, she wouldn't do it this way. You have to understand this. This is an English girl from a very specific background. And in all fairness to her, she did it. And I thought she was wonderful. So I'm proud of that.
No, and quite rightly.
And also, I must tell you, Ian McKellen, in those days, we couldn't portray this. You know, he's the father of her child in the film. They only had one encounter out of which she becomes pregnant. Yeah. But he actually was supposed to be bisexual. And sexually ambivalent. And we couldn't do it, because in those days you couldn't do it, so we had to sort of imply. And so we had quite a bit of fun on that front, and trying to be subtle.
Yeah, no, it's well. He's a fascinating, mysterious presence on screen. Yeah. And if I may ask, another thing I noticed thematically about your work, there's this whole two aspects of it. Him as this representative of the BBC, kind of this revered institution, and her experience in the NHS with her pregnancy and after she has the baby, where she's really bullied. And, you know, we have such a sentimental and, you know, quite nostalgic view of the NHS in particular in the past. This is quite an acerbic view of how these places could be quite cruel to people.
Yes.
And you, again, that seems to be something you drew on.
Well, it was criticism. I mean, even though I counteract the present president, who has put a negative aspect onto our medical system, it still is one of the best in the world, but it can be criticized. So that's what we did. We criticized it because there can be areas of impersonality, and someone has to stand up and scream. And she does.
Yeah, that's amazing, powerful. Right, a couple more stills, and we've got one more set of clips to show you. And The Possession of Joe Delaney, 1972, which is the film you made with Shirley MacLaine about exorcism before The Exorcist. Mm-hmm. What was it like making this?
It was very weird. I had never done anything like this before, and I don't think I will ever again. Because actually, maybe you may think I'm being melodramatic, but I did a lot of research into possession, and the Puerto Rican and population in New York, especially, they're a thing called espiritismo, and they actually believe in it, and they do it. And in my case, I researched it. I went to private homes, into kitchens, living rooms, and witnessed. When we shot this sequence, it was in an actual apartment of where they're trying to exorcise the evil spirit out of this, supposedly her brother who's been possessed. She's an Upper East Side, very rich woman who patronizes her servants for Puerto Ricans. And so I was trying to do a combination of social comment on New York at the time as well as the horror element. And the exorcism sequence itself actually got out of hand. The man playing the exorcist suddenly lost it and foamed at the mouth, fell backwards and screamed and yelled, and we had to cut the cameras. And he got up and he ran at me and tried to pin me against the wall, and he had to be dragged off. Anyway, the point was this: we had to finish the filming. And later, one of the extras, Puerto Rican women, came to me and she said, you know, you've been doing something very dangerous here. You really have to do something about it, otherwise it's going to harm you in the future. And I was absolutely shaken. We had to complete the filming. And if you actually look at the film now, we had to complete it in two separate segments. Continuity-wise, there are certain things that don't match. But I was exhausted by the end of it. And I don't think I'd ever want to touch anything like this again.
Doctors, indeed, yeah. Right.
Shirley was very good in it.
Right, we have time for last set of clips, which are from Intimate Contact, made in 1987. This was an ITV drama series, later repeated on Channel 4, and the first to tackle the reality of AIDS affecting an ordinary family. It was a middle-class family. And it dealt with the prejudices that people could face, so in schools as well as work. And I think in the first of the two scenes, we're going to see the reality of the wife, played by Claire Bloom, learning that the reason is for her husband's hospitalization.
We have to make a point, because today AIDS is almost secondary to being cured. I mean, you know, people treat it almost as another curable disease. At this time, it was a death sentence, so we've got to understand that.
People and it was seen as a plague. I mean, it really was.
It was. I mean, you didn't want to come anywhere near who might be contaminated. So this scene, far from being melodramatic, it has its points about a man who's been told he's got a death sentence, basically.
Look.
It's heterosexual AIDS, by the way, in this case.
And this is right in the heart of, you know, the controversy. How difficult was it to make at the time? How controversial was it at the time?
It was very controversial. People were dying. I mean, literally every day there was newspaper reports of another person, well-known personality. So, I mean, at the time, it was like, it's unimaginable. It was a sort of, it was a disease that had caused deaths. It was a holocaust of this particular illness. It's very hard to imagine that today, because it's already been contained and dealt with. But at the time, it was just horrendous. So it may seem a bit melodramatic now, but it wasn't then. And we even have a scene in it where the doctor explains what AIDS is and how you catch it. I thought Alma Cullen did a wonderful script, because it dealt with before, everyone said it was a gay plague, but this was the first script that dealt with heterosexual AIDS.
Which is a huge deal. We shouldn't forget the Sunday Times at the time was obsessed with the idea that heterosexuals couldn't get AIDS.
Exactly.
And
it was way ahead of its time. And when we did this, a lot of people said, oh, wait a minute, isn't that a bit exaggerated? No, it's not. And it showed the downfall of this particular middle-class family from being up there to how it began to disintegrate. And the woman has to pick herself up. First of all, total denial. And then her gradual understanding, and in the script, it interwoven with other people who've got the same thing, and there's a gay couple in it who she first of all rejects, and then she finally befriends them because they introduced her in the hospital. And the guy who's looking after his partner talks to her, and they begin to understand what it means, that they've got something in common, which is death, and people they love who they're going to lose, and the different reactions. So, I mean, for me, it was very important as a subject, because I had friends who were going through all this.
Right, let's take some questions, if you've got on anything. They don't all have to be about Doctor Who, but we've got a microphone in the middle there. Question.
Thank you for asking. It is something very special, but also it needs to be interpreted in a way that is acceptable to an audience. And something you've mentioned, that we can get very close to somebody with a camera, and you don't have to project. Every nuance can be seen, as long as I as a director and the actors understand which moments are important. So I did a lot of, I'd seen a huge amount. I'm very familiar with Edda Gabler. I've seen many productions. But the one that really got to me was the one that Ingmar Bergman did. And of course, I was heavily influenced by him anyway. You just have to see some of the stills. And I, by the way, feel thrilled that I'm sharing the same time as Ingmar Bergman at the BFI. He concentrated on people's faces, cries and whispers, for instance, the color schemes in his sets. I actually had asked for and got the permission from the BBC, which was a miracle, to go and actually look at Norwegian houses. And we looked at one and we saw how the furniture is placed and how people would have to therefore behave in that context. It wasn't just a comfortable Victorian set. It was very strange and set back from each other and sofas and chairs. But it influenced the way we actually did that. So I was actually very heavily influenced by Bergman. Well, first of all, I've never been approached by a Bollywood because they don't know who I am. The reason is that I'm based here. Thank you for asking, but honestly, Nick, if I was asked to do a Bollywood movie, I'd probably have to say no because my Hindi is very limited, and I'd have to direct it in sort of Roman English, with Roman italics, sorry, I mean. But no, I don't want to dismiss the idea of filming in India. I would love to film in India, but not a Bollywood movie. I would like to use India as a subject because my theory is this. After 300 years of a relationship between the two countries, I'm amazed that all we can do is constantly go back to Victoriana. And we don't seem to tackle the inbreeding that took place. I'm a result of it. I'm a beached whale of Indo-British culture. And I think there are so many subjects that we should be dealing with. Unfortunately, I'm not a good enough writer to do this. I can supply people with ideas. But I would love to film an entire series in India, but let's see what happens.
Close up, so you see the soul of the actor, really. It's just wonderful.
Yes. That's so beautifully put. I agree. I've been watching so many of them. Did you have a view on that?
I found that very exciting.
Well, I have a way of approaching something. I believe in showing where these people are. There are certain directors who shoot totally in close-ups and then you don't know where you are. You know what I mean? I need to establish exactly where these people are and where they move within that environment. Then I try to show them in their close-ups because then you get to know where and who they are. So it's something that I've learned because I look at other people's work and I try to understand what they're doing. And actually, I'm not the only one who does this. It's just that I'm happy that you comment on it.
Well, it struck me this evening, and I see quite a lot of films, but it was just so exciting to get so close to the actor, to get so close.
Well, there's nothing as eloquent as a face. And an expression on a face, and even and a camera catches a lie. That's the other thing. You can usually tell when somebody's not very good. And if you notice, I try to keep away from them at distances. But when somebody's really good, and I have the honor of saying that because here Ginny McKenna is here, I thought her performance and at the end in that trial scene was just so special. Adela's pulling back and saying, I made a mistake. Mm-hmm. It could so easily have not been what it was. I remember saying to Ginny, because in the script it says she breaks down. You know, she starts to cry. And I said to Ginny, try to suppress, hold it in. You're crying, but I don't want it to be externalized. And that's what she gave it. It was an internal grief that finally came out.
Thank you. Really thoughtful questions. And Waris, I wonder, do you think your 23-year-old self, what do you think he would have made of you being here at the BFI, having a retrospective, 55 years and still working?
Well, I'm thrilled. I mean, you know, it's lovely to be able to be acknowledged.
Enjoyed it.
And I think it's wonderful to be able to sit here and talk to everybody and hopefully interest them in what I've done. And I don't want to give up.
No, that's really clear. You're not giving up anytime soon.
Well, you know what? There's a time and a place for it all. And they all say, well, why don't you just sit on your laurels or enjoy what you've got or had? And I say, no, because won't you start sitting there staring at walls, then you might as well give up. So I'm still working on a screenplay, and I'm hoping to get it financed. It's not easy these days, unless you've got Netflix behind you. So it's, you know, independent filmmaking is not easy, but one continues in the best way one can. And this, to me, is as good as it gets.
Perfect.